Hello and welcome to Digital Nation, your weekly UK travelogue using stories filmed by the country's local TV journalists. In this week's show, we take a trip in a very unusual shed. We play baseball with a group of students in the home of rugby. And we'll pull on our walking boots in Scotland. And if you have any comments on the show, you can use the hashtag DigitalNation. Our first visit this week is to a Bristol kickboxing gym. In a sport dominated by males, kickboxing has two young rising stars, both of them female. With an obesity epidemic showing that some of us lack the motivation to get enough exercise, what a refreshing change to hear of fully booked classes in such an energetic pastime.
They call her the Ginger Ninja at the Cobra Gym in Kingswood, and together with Tia Ayton, Holly Rose Haskins is making a big impression at an early age in kickboxing. In fact, between them, they've won so many belts, it's virtually impossible to find somewhere to keep them all. And there are bound to be more to add to their collection in the near future.
OK, I'm here with Holly and Tia then, and tell us first how old you are, Holly.
9 and 10 years old,
and already you've got all these belts between you. Tell us about some of them, Holly. What have you won so far?
I've won a English title belt, a TFC, a WRSA, and France.
You won in France?
Twice
in France?
And yeah.
So you travel about a bit. What about you, Tia? What have you won?
I have won a TFC, two Britishes, two Englishes, and three Europeans.
Three European championships?
Yeah, and I got a national one.
Wow.
Two, I think. My dad says if I keep the way I'm going, I might get to the Olympics.
How good are they?
Very good. Very good. Exceptional. But they put in the training to be that good. They're up here 5-6 times a week. So even Sundays, they come hill running, then they come back here and train. But they are exceptional, this too, yeah.
It's a growing sport in this country.
It's a very big growing sport, yeah. Hopefully, I see it in the Olympics.
Yeah, they were just saying they're about to go to the Olympics.
Exactly. And it'd be a shame if they can't.
In Leeds, there's a bar once known as a refuge for the members of the LGBT community that's recently had its existence recognised with a blue plaque awarded by the City Council. Originally called the Hope and Anchor, the new penny represents how far the lesbian, gay, bisexual and transgender community has advanced in Leeds since the early days of discrimination.
It's been a landmark of the lesbian, gay, bisexual and transgender community in Leeds for over 6 decades. And now, the new penny has been given a stamp of approval in the form of a blue plaque, a city-wide scheme that commemorates people and places of historical significance.
Back then, even only 10, 12 years ago, society was in a different place, so it was a very different environment to come into, and having only just come out as well, it was a very odd place for me to step into.
As successful as the bar is today, it's not just about being a place to party. Attitudes towards LGBT people weren't always as accepting as they are in 2016. And back in 1953, the Hope and Anchor, as it was called then, became a sort of safe haven. And as much as the ceremony here was a celebration of this establishment, it was also a chance to reflect on how far the LGBT community in Leeds and across the UK has come.
But today's about looking back in the history, back to the days when the community was more hidden away. People have talked today about how this bit of Leeds was the wrong side of Leeds. You wouldn't have gone there because it was the bit that nobody went to. And this 40 years ago was the heart of the LGBT community in the city. And now we see such a vibrant community in the city. But it's important to look back in the history and just look at some of the past and look at how we've got to where we've got to today.
With pubs closing all the time, the fact that, you know, like these venues are all doing, you know, pretty well, especially in the financial climate, they're all doing well. It means that there's got to be some attraction to them.
It seems the new penny's long and colourful history is set to continue for many years to come.
There are two things I know about snails. One, they can be an annoying pest to gardeners. And two, they can taste great with a bit of garlic butter. However, Knott's TV have taken the snail trail even further. And in the next clip, we get a fascinating insight into their problems with reproduction.
Oh, I know what you're thinking. Richard, if you're looking for love, you need to raise your standards. Now, I appreciate the thought, but I'm not looking for myself. I'm looking for a special someone for a very special snail.
This is the Lonely Lefty, yeah, so this is a very, very rare snail. It's a very rare form of the common garden snail. So garden snails, commonest snail in the country. You can find them just about anywhere you look outside. You can find them in the plant pots, and very messy gardens are great for them. But this one is different because his shell coils in a mirror image way compared with all other snails that I've ever seen of this variety. So he's a mirror image, body and shell. And that leads to the complication. So if you're a snail, your body is very asymmetric. So, and what that really means for them is when they try to mate, the bits are in the wrong position and they can't get it together. That's why he's lonely.
In hope of learning more about this snail, Dr. Angus Davison wants another snail with this rare shell so they can do what young lovers do and make some very rare slimy babies.
We'd really like to get the public involved in trying to help us. Could be make a very valuable contribution to this. Easiest way to do that is to find five or so snails, lay them on the ground facing the same direction, and if the coil all goes in the same way, then that's what you'd expect. But very rarely you might get one going the other way. So this one, if you go from the spire down, coils anti-clockwise. That's the rare type.
Right, I need to start getting myself looking for some snails.
If you can't see or are visually impaired, it'd be easy just to stay within your comfort zones. But that's not the case for some erstwhile fashion models from Norfolk. Taking to the catwalk, they put themselves in the hands of the professionals to raise money for the charity for the blind, hoping they'll look as good as they feel, including the dog.
Measuring up for a big night, a team of models who are either blind or have visual impairments are taking to the catwalk tonight in a fashion show, all to raise money for the Norfolk and Norwich Association for the Blind. Ed Bates has been blind since birth, and Carl Porter lost his sight at an early age. They're being sized up for evening wear and helping these models step out of their comfort zone.
It was very nice to do something a bit different, and we got a really good reception that night, so I was really pleased with how it went. I think the thing that scared me was I was the last one out of the doorway, so I heard everybody else getting a really good reaction, and I sort of stood there thinking, what's it going to be like?
I think that when you can't see, you either stick to what you know, which is kind of something that I like to do. It's really hard to know what's out there, really, so you know, what people are wearing, what you think looks and feels good without having to experience it.
Rachel Andrews has a condition called myopic macular degeneration, which means she's got no sight in her left eye and no central vision in her right. But she loves her clothes and is looking forward to taking to the catwalk with her equally stylish guide dog, Stella.
I've always liked clothes, I've always liked looking good, and I didn't see why that should stop when I became visually impaired. So, you know, I work very hard about it. So I have colour detectors at home, and I ask people before I go out, make sure I've got things on the right way round. But yeah, I like to match with Stella. I think, you know, she's obviously part of my life, so she should be part of my look as well.
The charity works with 20,000 people in Norfolk with sight problems, helping them stay at home and stay independent whenever they can. There, Donna Minto says it's a wonderful opportunity for their volunteer models.
There's going to be a few nerves on the night, but I think most people actually would love to walk a catwalk and just show off. And, you know, if you've got that sort of personality, which some of our models have, it's great to see them actually being able to come out and really show off and show their personalities. And they've all got big personalities.
So although these models might not be able to see everything in their wardrobe for tonight, it's definitely not going to stop them from looking good.
Recently, historians discovered evidence that a book of Psalms kept in a Cambridge college for 450 years belonged to Thomas à Becket. Previously ignored as a relic in favour of clothes or bones, the book contains an inscription placing it on his shrine in the Middle Ages. Cambridge TV went along to investigate.
This book of Psalms, or Psalter, has been well kept in the Parker Library at Corpus Christi College for the past 450 years. But its significance wasn't fully recognised until the librarian here, Dr. Christopher de Hamel, spoke with a fellow historian about the medieval tendency to not use writings as relics. It turns out one of the few exceptions to this rule may have already been well known to him.
It's an odd fact that books, generally, in the Middle Ages, books were not regarded as relics, even when they belonged to saints. They were interested in bones of saints, bits of clothes that have belonged to saints, and generally not books. Well-known observation. which I mentioned conversationally to a fellow historian over lunch here not long ago, and he said, I know an exception. He said, do you know there was a Psalter on Thomas Becket's shrine which was described in the sacrist's list of the shrine in 1321, and he produced for me a description, their description of this Psalter, which was then displayed to pilgrims. And one of those things you read through with a kind of shiver of recognition, because word for word it corresponds with an inscription which is on the flyleaf of this book, and that sudden realization that it's the same manuscript. And it has an inscription here at the end in an Elizabethan hand, this is not medieval, saying this Psalter, bound in boards, I'm translating roughly, bound in boards of silver and silver gilt and decorated with gemstones, formerly belonged to N, an unmentioned Archbishop of Canterbury, and came into the hands of Thomas Becket when he was Archbishop, as is written in the old writing at the end. And there is nothing at the end, it's been rebound. And that inscription, well known, has been roundly mocked by everyone who's ever worked on the manuscript. They say that's a piece of Elizabethan fantasy. But now that we know the Psalter that was on the shrine described as exactly that, it must have had on the flyleaf the same inscription written by the sacrist. And I think there is no doubt at all that this is that book which was displayed to pilgrims as having belonged to Becket.
The Psalter earned rare relic status because people believed Becket was holding it when King Henry II's knights cut him down. Whether this is true is disputed now. There are no traces of blood after all. Becket's Psalter will remain on display here. Only the description next to it has changed.
And that brings us to the end of part one, and time for this week's quiz. Which of the following is not an official royal residence? Is it A, Sandringham? B, Chequers? Or C, Balmoral? Take the corgis out for a walk and we'll give you the answer after the break. Welcome back to Digital Nation. Before the break, we asked you which of the following is not an official royal residence. And the answer is B, Chequers. Chequers is the official residence of the Prime Minister in Buckinghamshire. As a recent report showed, the world is experiencing the decline of some of our best known and loved wild animals. So when a safari park in Glasgow had a new pride of 6 lion cubs, they made sure they were well prepared before their presentation to an adoring public. Even if there was a few scratches to endure.
Well, we had quite an ageing pride here at the safari park, and we needed to expand on our pride, so we've brought in a new male, Zulu, so this is the start of his legacy now.
Today, our lion cubs are 12 weeks old. We're just giving them their final vaccination, giving them a wee health check, ready to go out and get mixed with the rest of the pride.
So today we were vaccinating the lion cubs. These guys have two sets of vaccinations, one at 9 weeks and one at 12 weeks, much like the normal domestic cats. So this is their second set of inoculations. That will afford them a degree of protection for the next year. So they'll have yearly annual vaccinations after this, and they should be able to be turned out with the other lions and just mixed.
The most difficult part's the catching them. I've got a couple of war wounds on me, but nothing too bad, eh? It looks worse than what it is, it's just a couple of wee scratches. They're 12 weeks old, they're getting big, they've got sharp claws, they've got teeth, they're feisty now, eh? They're not exactly like tame little pussy cats, eh?
So it's phenomenal to get the cubs out. All the staff are really sort of excited and eager to get them out and about. Today sort of marks the start of probably 3 years of them jumping around, playing, jumping off their platforms, chasing one another, and generally enjoying themselves as they go.
What's the most popular sport in Wales? Well, most people would answer rugby, and they'd probably be correct. However, there's a group of students bucking the trend and introducing the American national game of baseball to Swansea University. Who's on first?
Me and four other students that are still here, some of them, we started the club together. They were actually housemates. When we first started it, it was really just, you know, us students that wanted to play sport, that didn't require too much obligations during the week, so we would have time to do other student stuff like drinking, studying, and whatnot. But as it went on, the program, I slightly took it in a much more serious direction, while the other guys still helped me because it's relatively new sport in Wales.
First base is a hardcore, isn't it?
Yeah. Yeah. Well, that's why we've got Sushan on first.
Who's the guy? He's your hot shot, basically. Safe hands.
Last year, we were all about the fun. We were trying to get more people involved in the American sport. But yeah, like I said, you can see by the numbers, it's just taken off this year. We're now hoping to be part of the NUBL League, which is a league set up by multiple universities.
What's the hardest thing to teach anyone who's it's their first time trying baseball? Because it's a very technical sport.
Batting, really. I mean, like, here in the UK, you have cricket, and it's a completely different swing. You swing like underarm. Baseball, it's overarm. It's quite a difficult skill to teach.
Well, I'm not allowed to play anymore. Too many home runs, they get jealous. But how fantastic is this? A baseball team in Swansea. The Swansea Seagulls, look them up on Facebook. They need members. Boys and girls, you're all welcome. Doesn't matter if you played before, they'll train you up.
Back in 1936, a bill called the Means Test caused widespread anger and unrest amongst the poor in Scotland. Two groups of protesters, one from the east and the other from the west of the country, united in protest and marched all the way to London. Joined on the way by like-minded people from England and Wales, they finally assembled in Hyde Park to voice their objections.
...1936 in Scotland was a time of mass poverty, hunger and worklessness. The poor lived under the threat of the hated means test, by which the government could gain access to their lives and judged whether they were quite poor enough to receive state aid. It bred anger and rebellion. That same poor organised themselves into a national unemployed workers' movement. They planned a march on London. This was no ragtag bunch of men, though. They were organised, drilled, set into companies and divisions. From Scotland, there were to be two contingents. One from the east of 186 men, and one from the west of 275. The plan was to rendezvous at Hyde Park in the early winter. On October the 4th, the Eastern Marchers held a rally here at Leith Links. Thousands were present to support them. The next day, they and the Western contingent set off for London. Along the way, they picked up 1,000 English and Welsh unemployed marchers. It must have made for some sight, this emaciated ghost army striding into often prim shire towns of England. On November the 8th, Western and Eastern contingents marched into Hyde Park to be greeted by a quarter of a million people. It was, said the Daily Herald, the mightiest demonstration London had ever seen. You can break me down.
You can take me down. What do you get if you join a threshing machine with a steam tractor? Here's Creative Kingdom.
In 1915, with World War I still in its infancy, a group of middle-ranking British officers got together to convince the government that armoured transport was the way forward, and they caught the ear of the first Lord of the Admiralty, a chap called Winston Churchill. After consulting with scores of experts, he decided that one place alone was up to the job, a company in Lincoln called William Foster & Co. Now, this company were used to making threshing machines and steam tractors, which wouldn't be much cop on the battlefields of France, but thanks to William Tritton and Major Walter Wilson, they bashed together the first ever tank, which they called Little Willie. 1 year later, the first tanks were pressed into service, and they've been in use ever since. Proof once again that when it comes to creativity, innovation, and laying down heavy tracks, mint Lincoln mint!
Back in the 1800s, oysters were so plentiful, they used to use them in pies. Then the food industry popularised them and they became a sought-after delicacy. So, when a recent survey in the Solent found the native oyster population was decreasing, a group of scientists began research into the reasons why.
It's tough times for the oyster population in the Solent.
The sea dweller is an essential part of the marine ecosystem, but the change of water quality and temperature, as well as invasive predators and overfishing, have made it a rare species in our waters. That's why over the past year, scientists from the University of Portsmouth have been working on a pilot project to see if they can repopulate the Solent with 10 million of the threatened marine creatures.
They'll probably be put in over a series of 2 to 5 years to get the population back up to the stage that it is what's called self-recruiting. So it's a dense enough population in high enough numbers that it can reproduce naturally on the seabed and self-populate itself. We will be using hatchery oysters that are grown up to the right size, around 50 or 60 millimetres, and then either just put on the relayed on the seabed in protected areas, or they're actually housed in artificial reef constructs, which again are protected from fishing.
If the native oyster came back to the Solent, there would be many advantages.
Having a healthy population of oysters in the Solent will mean that we have far better water quality. Aside from that, on a native oyster shell, you can often get 15 other species just living on that shell. It's not just the fact that we would like the native oyster back for water quality, but it's also that they bring with it a habitat for lots of other native biodiversity.
Our final visit is to Oxfordshire to meet a man who's taken the idea of customising his garden shed to the extreme. Dispensing with the usual contents of a spade, fork and plant pots, he's not content with just driving around in his man cave. His next challenge is to break the 100 miles an hour speed record. I hope he doesn't drive in his wellies.
You've probably used yours to store your wheelbarrow or compost in, but gardener Kevin Nix uses his shed to break world records. The Chipping Norton resident has converted his old motor into a vehicle that can reach up to 95 miles an hour.
There is basically a whole car inside it, apart from the bits you don't need, like the roof and things. And I was going to scrap it, but it was too good to scrap. Came up with the idea, set to, and built it, basically. It took me a year of walking past this car thinking, I've got to do something with it, I'll scrap it. No, it's too good to scrap. People just throw things away nowadays when actually you can recycle them.
Despite now holding the world record for fastest shed, Kevin didn't initially build it to be the quickest.
It's just over 2 metres wide, same length as the standard Volkswagen Passat, because the front is actually fixed on where the original front was. It weighs 2.25 tonnes, because the whole vehicle is steel framed. It's made out of 3mm steel box. So it's kind of like a car with a full roll cage right the way around it.
As you can imagine, driving a vehicle like Kevin's can get quite the response from the public.
It still amazes me. I never ever expected to have the reaction from people that I would get. And it's, you can go up a street in any busy town and just everybody smiles. And that's from, you know, little children and old ladies, absolutely everybody in between. And it's a humbling feeling, just for a minute, to be able to put a smile on somebody's face.
And that's it for this week's episode of Digital Nation. You can watch previous episodes on the BBC website, www.bbc.co.uk/digitalnation. Or why not visit the website of your own local TV channel? So until next time, goodbye.